is a very powerful distribution which is free Linux operating system. Linux is powerful but can be scary to new users, and Ubuntu aims to make it user friendly. In this course, I will show you how to get started with Ubuntu Linux. I will show you around the desktop version of release 18.04. I will show you a few ways to install Ubuntu. You will think up how to navigate the GNOME desktop environment quickly. I will introduce some of the software that comes with the Ubuntu desktop, and then I will show you how to complete some common tasks. Finally, I have shown you some of the more advanced features that you might come across and extending your knowledge of Linux. This course is aimed at people who need to understand the basics of the desktop environment, not command line users or system administrator. My assumption is that you want to start exploring Linux as an alternative to Windows or Mac OS, or that you work for one of the many companies or organizations that are beginning to switch to Linux and you need to get a jump start in that new environment. So grab some coffee or tea, let's get started. Before starting the course, first what you should know. I have tried to put this course together with as a few prerequisites as possible. One of the biggest assumptions I have to make is that you are familiar with either Mac OS or Windows operating system with the basic understanding of the general ideas behind using a computer desktop environment. I'm also assuming you have access to a flash drive of at least 2 GB or larger. Throughout the course, I will use a flash drive for different things, and if you don't have one, that's fine. But if you have a flash drive that you can erase it completely, you will be able to follow along a little bit better. Most important thing, I will try to avoid technical jargons in this course, except where I really need to use it. If something goes over your head, don't worry. Ubuntu was designed to be usable and user-friendly, but sometimes technical terms and ideas come up because there's no alternative. When this happens in this course, I will walk you through it, but you need to be prepared to see a little bore speak and understanding how to deal with it. Those activities will take some time, so be sure to budget at least another 30 to 45 minutes for that, depending on your internet connection speed and how fast your hardware is. Even though I will show you how to install Linux natively on the computer, throughout the course I will be using an installation of Linux inside a virtual machine, simply because it's a lot easier to record and because you will be able to replicate the setup exactly on your Windows or Mac computer. If you are following along with native install on a computer, things should look the same. But there might be minor differences that you will have to work around. If you are eager to get started installing, jump to chapter 1. If you have already got Ubuntu installed on the system, then jump to chapter 2. If you don't already have an installation of Ubuntu, let's take a few minutes to get it installed. In order to get Ubuntu installed in an environment where we can learn about it, we need to get the installer. Linux installer comes as a disk image, large file that represents a CD or DVD called an ISO file or ISO image. We can download these files from a distro website. In the case of Ubuntu, that is ubuntu.com. I should note that if you are using an older computer, one with a 32-bit processor, you won't be able to install this version of Ubuntu on your system. You will need to look for an older version. But if your computer is from about 2008 or later, you can maybe use the 64-bit version. Check your system specs to be certain. I will visit Ubuntu.com and click through to download the current version of the desktop flavor. I will mouse over downloads and then choose desktop. Then I will click the download button and then I will click OK. As you can see on the screen, this file takes a while to download, so be sure to set aside some time to allow it to finish. Once we have the installer downloaded, we can use it in a few different ways. We can use a USB drive to create an installer, or we can use the disk image to install within a virtual machine. The next lecture cover a few different methods to install Ubuntu. Now that we have an installation image, they are all optional and they don't count toward course completion. So pick whichever applies to your situation and skip the rest if you like. So next chapter, we are going to installing Ubuntu on virtual machine, so be with me. See you in next lecture. One of the ways to install Linux is inside a virtual machine. Virtual machines are little containers that hold an operating system and run it within another operating system. And this way of installing Linux is great if you are learning or testing or either can't or don't want to modify your system hard drive and boot setup. It's a good place to start because there's absolutely no risk of overwriting or harming your current operating system or data. You can even take a virtual machine with you to different computer on an external hard drive. However, when running as a virtual machine, your Linux installation won't have access to all of your computer's resources. You will be sharing RAM and graphic memory, and it will have to compete with the native or host operating system for access to disk and hardware resources. If you need to use Linux to do resource intensive thing, like working with video or large dataset, a virtual environment, maybe this is not a best choice, but for most users, especially for getting your feet wet with the new operating system, it's just fine. Or making some R&D lab, like installing any web server, doing some testing. And for learning point of view, this is the best choice. I will show you how to set up a virtual machine using VirtualBox. VirtualBox is a free application available from Oracle. You could also use commercial software like VMware or others, and the process will be just about the same. But I am using VirtualBox because it's free and it's available for Windows, Mac and Linux. So it's just about as accessible as can be. VirtualBox is available from virtualbox.org, as you can see on the screen. To find the installer for your system, click the big blue button and then choose the platform package for your system. I have already downloaded and installed on my system. Depending on what operating system you are using, the software will look a little bit different. Go ahead and go through the installation process and open up the application. Installation process is very simple. You can go with the default options. Just click next, next, next. If you want to learn more about VirtualBox software itself, be sure to check my course on Udemy, which is purely for Oracle VirtualBox, and you can learn a lot about VirtualBox and for using for different setup, your testing or R&D environment. So after installation, just click on new, as you can see on the screen, and I will give you my virtual machine name. I will call it Ebento Desktop, and since I use the word Ebento, VirtualBox has changed the type and version of the VM down here automatically for me, as you can see on the screen. I will click Next on this screen. Then I will decide how much RAM to give my virtual machine. More RAM means more programs can be open at the same time and run well. For trying out Linux, I recommend about 2 GB or 2048 MB. You will want to stay within the green area under the slider bar to make sure that your host computer still has enough RAM to run well. As you can see on the screen, you can move back and forward, or everything will get annoying and slow. I will click Next, and now I will choose to create a virtual hard disk. I will choose VDI and click Next. As you can see step by step on the screen, then I am presented with the choice whether to grow the virtual machine disk dynamically. The file on my host computer gets bigger as the virtual machine disk file fills up, or to do a fixed size, which makes a file of whatever size I choose to make the hard drive and sets that space aside from the very beginning. Actually, this is not a better choice because it reserves the space on your system, your host machine. I like to make a dynamic file since I don't want to take up all of the space on my host system. When it's going to be full of nothing for a long time, I will click Next. Now I have the opportunity to name the hard drive file. I will just leave it set to whatever the program suggested. I will change the size to 100 GB. Remember, the space is not being taken up yet. This is good time to think about whether you want to move the virtual machine around on a hard drive or a flash disk. Make sure the hard drive files will fit on that device. Another thing to consider here is whether you are going to back up your virtual machine file. VirtualBox puts a folder inside your user folder on the host machine in default setting, which contains a virtual machine, and that usually within the scope of automatic backup. I will click Create. At this point, we have container for Linux installation, but no Linux yet. Let's fix that. I need to install the operating system from the ISO disk image, which I downloaded earlier. And to do that, I will connect to ISO to the virtual machine as a virtual CD drive. I will click on my virtual machine and choose Setting, go to Storage, and under the IDE controller, I will click the empty slot. As you can see on the screen, then over here on the right, I will click the little CD icon and go to choose a virtual optical disk file. Then I will navigate to my downloads folder and select the ISO image. And then I will click open. I will click OK and back on the listing of my virtual machines. I will choose mine and click start. To get rid of these messages at the top, I will click the crossed out comment bubble and I will maximize the window. The installer starts up after a few moments and gives me the option to try Ebento or to install Ebento. As you can see on the screen, I will click Install Ebento. The next screen asks me to choose the keyboard for my language. This is set correctly for me to US English, so I will click Continue. The next screen asks if I want to perform a normal installation or a minimal installation. A normal installation comes with a web browser, some utilities, some office software, some games and media players. A minimal installation only comes with the basic utilities and a web browser. For this course, I will choose normal installation because I want to show you some of the software that comes with the Ubuntu Linux. I'm also given the option to download update while installing Ubuntu. In order to save time during the installation process, I will uncheck that I am also given the option to install third-party software for graphic and Wi-Fi hardware. Here in my virtual machine, I don't need to do that, so I leave that unchecked. Then I will click continue. Now I will choose to erase the whole virtual disk and install Ubuntu. There is no risk to your data at this point. All of this erasing is happening within the virtual hard drive file we created earlier. You can choose to encrypt the volume if you like. If you do, it will ask for a password whenever the system boots before you log in. For testing out Linux in the virtual environment, this is maybe overkill, as is the next option, which makes it easier to increase the size of the boot drive later on. I will leave them unchecked and I will click install now. I will click continue to confirm the changes and I will make sure that my time zone is set correctly. Then I will click continue. Here I can set my username and my computer name and a password. I will leave this set to ask me for my password when I log in. But in the testing environment, you could choose to skip that. I will click continue. You will see a couple of informational slides during the process, which takes a few minutes, but through the miracle of this lecture, let's fast forward to the end. Now with the installation complete, I need to restart the virtual machine so it can boot up into the new install. As you can see on the screen, you may be prompted to hit enter to restart the machine, and here my Ubuntu login screen. I will click my username and I will type in my password to log in. I want to point your attention to the bottom right corner of the VirtualBox window. On my screen, it has a green arrow and it says right control. If you are using a Mac, it may say left command. This is what referred to in the VirtualBox as the host key. VirtualBox uses the host key to do some of the things that it does. For example, I need to use that for some commands, like if I go full screen on Windows here, I press the right control and F. Then I will click switch. To exit this mode, you will need to the host key and F again. If you are following along with me in a virtual machine, you are ready to go and you can skip to the next chapter. But if you want to see how to install Ubuntu natively on a computer, I will do that later in this chapter. So be with me. See you in next lecture. In order to use Ubuntu natively, to have it be the only operating system running at a time on a computer, I will need to make an installation or boot disk, and usually that comes in the form of a USB hard drive or thumb drive or optical media like DVD. I will take a moment to create an installer for a USB thumb drive. To make a bootable USB drive on Windows, I will download a program called Roface. I will scroll down here and choose the latest version to download. As you can see on the screen, I will save it to my download folder. When that downloaded, I will open up my download folder and open the application. I will say yes to allow it to check for application update online. I will plug in my USB drive that I want to use and I will select it from the device menu. I will leave the boot selection menu alone and then I will choose select here. I will open up the ISO image that I want to use to create the installer. I will press open and we are ready. I will click start. Roface is telling me that it needs to download some additional software, so I will click yes. Then it asks me which mode I want to use to write the data. It's recommending this ISO image mode, and I will click OK. And finally, I am warned that all of the data on this device will be destroyed. As you can see on the screen, I am OK with this, so I will click OK. This process will take a while, and we will speed up the video. When it's done, make sure to eject the drive and set it aside. Now we have a drive that we can use to install Ubuntu on our native laptop or desktop. Now that I have a Ubuntu installer, I am ready to install it in a system. That system need to be shut off, and it's good idea to make a backup of it, because you install during the installation process we will changing the configuration of the hard drive, and especially if you are trying to install Ubuntu alongside another operating system, there's a risk of data loss unless you are careful. In this case, we will install Ubuntu. So it's the only operating system on this computer, meaning that any data currently on this computer hard drive will be erased. Having our installation disk ready, I will make sure my computer is turned off, and I will plug in my USB drive. Now I need to tell the computer to start up from this installation disk rather than its built-in hard drive. To do this, I need to press a particular key during the computer startup sequence. On a PC, you will usually have to press F10 or F12 or F1 or something like that while the system is powering up. It's usually displayed briefly at the boot screen, so keep a sharp eyes out for it. You might have to hit escape or something like that during a logo screen to get the key information. Of course, depending on your model of computer, what you see will differ a little bit. Check with your manufacturer documentation to be sure, or you can go into your computer BIOS where the system configuration and startup option are, and change the boot order of your devices. So that USB is the first, but that's more advanced than what we need right now. If you are using a Mac, power the system down, then power it back on, and while it's starting, press and hold the option key. Go ahead and plug in the USB disk. When this is going on, if everything goes as planned, you will see a light gray screen with some icon on it, including one that indicates the USB drive. I will power my computer on, and then I will press F10 to bring up the boot selector on startup. I will choose the device I want to start from. In this case, one of these USB entries. If you don't pick right the first time, restart and try to different option. Now there's a two different screens you might see at this point. Depending on how your system is set up, if it's set up for EFI, which is the newer, you will see black and white menu with a few options. If your system is not using EFI, you will see a window with buttons that say try Ubuntu and install Ubuntu. I will pick install. The installer work for a few seconds, and it auto detect my language. I will confirm my keyboard layout and language and press continue. Following that, I am given the option to connect to Wi-Fi. I will skip this for now. If your computer is plugged in to Ethernet, you maybe won't see this screen, and then I can choose if I want to do a normal installation or minimal installation. A normal installation gives you a web server, utilities, office software and some other software, and minimal installation just give you a web browser and some utilities. Throughout the rest of this course, we will be exploring some of those Office software program and utility. So I'm going to choose normal installation, and down here I will choose to install the third party software for graphics. Then I am asked if I want to install Ubuntu along aside Windows 10 or to erase the disk and install Ubuntu. In this case, I am going to erase everything on this computer and make Ubuntu the only operating system that's available. I can also choose to encrypt the installation or use LVM, which will make it easier to extend the hard drive later on. But for now, while we are learning, I will leave those off. Then I am asked to confirm changes to the disk. Beyond this point, any data that was on those disks is gone. So before you click continue, make sure you have got a backup. I will choose my time zone and click continue. Here I can set my name and set my computer name, and then I can pick a username for myself and choose password that I will need to type in when I log into the computer. Now when the installation complete, I need to click restart now. Then I will unplug the installer and press enter, and my system will restart. When it does that, I will be greeted with the login screen. As you can see on the screen, I will type my password to log in. So this is done. Great. Let's starting exploring Ubuntu. Be with me. See you in next lecture. An Ubuntu 18.04, the desktop environment that gets installed by default, is called the GNOME shell. GNOME is the default, but you can install other desktop environment on Ubuntu. When we first log in into the new user, what's new in Ubuntu screen, as you can see on the desktop, I will click the green next button to go through this process and get to the desktop. Up at very top of the screen, there is a bar with the activity button, the clock and calendar, and some system status icons. These show the network status, the audio volume, the battery charge if you are on a laptop. And if you click this area, a status menu open up where you can control these elements, lock the screen and power off or restart the system. This top bar also becomes the application menu. When you open up an app, along the side, there is a launcher where you can put shortcut to programs you use frequently. This can be hidden, as we will see later, and taking up the majority of the screen is the desktop, as you might be familiar with the from Windows or Mac operating system. I will click on activities, and that brings up an area where I can switch between windows that are open and where I can type to search for programs. As you can see on the screen, I can click this little grid of dot here, which brings up a display of the software installed on the system. Along the right side of the screen, there is a list of workspaces, virtual desktops that I can move app windows to, and I can switch between them by pressing Ctrl plus Alt plus up and Ctrl plus Alt plus down. I will click on the activity button again and click here in the search bar, and I will type music. I can see that the system is showing me a music player. We'll take a look at that later, and files and folders that match that word. In this case, my music folder inside my home folder, I also get results that match from the Ubuntu software store, the app that lets you browse for new software to install on your system. There is a software synthesizers and an application to create sheet music. Those sound interesting, but I will cancel this for now by pressing escape, going back to the list of apps which I got to by clicking the dots in the lower left. I can see a variety of software that already installed here. Right clicking on an application gives me a menu where I choose to open a new window of the app and add it to my favorite on the launcher. As you can see on the screen, or show some details about the software. Let's add the app to my favorites on the left side. Once I have started using some apps, they will show up in the frequent section here and all contain the list of all of the GUI apps for this environment. To see them all, I can scroll up and down with the mouse, or I can click on this button here. I can get out of this view with escape, and I can call it back up again by pressing the start or command key on my keyboard. Or just by clicking the activities button again, I will open up a few apps here just to have something open. Notice that how when I open up an app, the top bar changes to the app menu where I can click the app name and see the menu for that application. I can switch between apps that are open using Alt plus Tab like on Windows, moving left and right to open apps, or Alt plus Shift plus Tab to move right to left. And if there's an app with more than one window open, I can switch between those in the switcher or move between them with Alt plus. Which on the US English keyboard is up in the upper left above Tab and to the left of number 1. In the app switcher, still holding the Alt key, I can press Q to quit the selected application. I can maximize an application window by dragging it up to the top of the screen, releasing it when I see the color highlight, clicking and dragging back down from the top returns the window to the previous size. I can do the same thing with the sides of the screen to snap an application to the left or right half of the desktop. This is useful for putting two apps side by side. Take a moment to familiar yourself with working in GNOME. As you use it, things will feel more natural. In the course of working with your computer, you will maybe want or need to change some settings. Here in GNOME, there is a central spot for system settings, and it's called System Settings. I can get it to by searching or from the status menu. As you can see on the screen, the settings are divided into a few different sections. At the top here on my system is the Wi-Fi, where I can look for and join Wi-Fi network. If I have an adapter plugged in, we will get into this in more detail. Below that is Bluetooth, where I can look for and pair Bluetooth devices like a keyboard, mouse, headphone, and so on. Again, if I have Bluetooth adapter, I can toggle Bluetooth on and off up here with the switch in the bar. We will take a look at this later. The next option here is to change the background. I can change the image that displays as the surface of my desktop and the image that shows up on the lock screen. There is a variety of images that come with the Bento. This one with the spices look interesting, and when I confirm my choice, the desktop background change. I can also choose a photo from the picture folder in my home folder if there's anything there, or I can choose a solid color instead of a photo. If I scroll down to the bottom here, notice the little white highlights that comes up indicating the end of the list. I will choose this nice medium blue color. The next option in my list is Dock. Remember, that's the launcher bar along the side of the screen where my favorites are. I can set it to auto hide when a window overlaps it. See how that works. I will leave that off for now. I can also change the size of icons and change where the dock is, on the left, the right, or at the bottom. The notification section lets you configure whether apps are allowed to pop up a notification on the screen when they want to share some information with you. Pop-ups here controls that, and you can also set whether you want them to appear on the lock screen, and below that you can control whether individuals' apps are able to send notifications. If you want to use more control, under search I can choose which of these items will appear in the search interface and change the order in which they appear as well. Region and language, let me change the language and display setting for my system. Whatever language you installed with will be selected here, and you can also add more languages and configure the format of dates, times, and numbers. And you can add input sources as well. If you change these options, you will need to restart your session in order for them to take effect. Universal access lets you change setting to increase the accessibility of different parts of the desktop, including changing the text size, configuring the zoom, adding visual alerts in addition to audio alert, and more. While a lot of these options are designed to improve the experience for people with particular difficulties, some of them can be helpful for users that don't necessarily need them as well. For quicker access to these settings, you can enable the Universal Access menu, which puts these options up here in the top bar. As you can see on the screen, the online account sections lets you add credentials for various online services, which allows app to use your information to configure things like email, sharing with social network, and so on. Then privacy. Privacy allows you to control some aspects of how the system behaves with regard to privacy. You can choose whether to allow location services to know where you are and whether to automatically report problems that occur. Be sure to explore these settings if you are privacy conscious and configure them to meet your needs. Sharing lets you change the name of your computer and enable and disable the sharing capabilities. Then sound controls the audio hardware and profile of the system. You can set the overall system volume and choose input and output devices. You can set the alert volume and the alert sound, which is the noise that happens when a dialogue pops up. I like to turn these off entirely. You can preview some sounds and choose what you like to have happen. The Applications tab shows whether an app is currently playing or recording audio. Power shows the battery charge information if you are on the laptop, and lets you choose when and whether to blank the screen after a while, and provide some other power options. Then network allows you to configure settings for the Ethernet adapter and like Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. We will take a look at the area in depth in a little bit later. Devices shows information about hardware connected to your system. I will click into here and it changed the sidebar to a list of hardware types. I don't have a lot of interesting hardware connected to this virtual machine, but click around on your system and see what's there. You can add a printer here in the printer areas, and you can choose what to do with different kind of removable media. Keyboard is a helpful area because you can set keyboard shortcut for all kinds of time saving actions. And displays let you change the orientation and resolution of the screen and let you turn on night light, which changes the color cast of the screen to make it more suitable for use before bedtime. I will click back in the top left and go to the primary window. As you can see on the screen, the last section here is details, where I can find out some information about the system itself. I will click it, and the first section within details is about, where I can see the distribution and my system info. Here's the amount of memory that the system has, its processor, and information about the version of GNOME, what type of OS this is, and some virtualization information. I can also see how big the hard drive is. In the date and time setting, I can select whether the system automatically sets its own clock. That's a good idea, but it does require internet access. So if you are working without internet at all, you will need to set the clock manually. You can change the time zone and how the time is formatted. Users, we will take a look at later on. That's where you can control what user accounts there are on the system. And default application is where you can set what application is the primary one for certain kinds of activities. There's a lot of option here in the setting app, so take some time to look around and familiarize yourself with the settings. When you need to change part of how your system works, this is a good place to start. In order to be connected to a network and to the internet, we have a few options. One option is plug into an Ethernet network. Here in the setting apps under network, I can control the setting from a connection to an Ethernet network. As I am already connected, working in a virtual machine gives me a virtual Ethernet adapter, and I can see that the link speed is 1000 megabits or 1 gigabit. I will click the gear here for some more information on the detail pane. There's a summary of my connections. A gigabit link, and here is my IP address, my IPv4 address. The IPv6 address is down here and it's not being used right now. Depending on your network, you may have an IPv6 address instead of IPv41, or you could have both active at the same time. The hardware address here is what often called the MAC address, the nearly unique identifier for a network device. And below that, there's the default root or gateway, which is the address of the network router that handling the network traffic for this system. Below that is the listing of the DNS server the system is using. These are often provided automatically by the router or another service on the network, and they are the server that the system talks to when it wants to find addresses for the web servers and other services. I can choose to connect to the profile automatically and whether to make my connection available to other users on the system. And if I am in a low bandwidth situation, I can choose to restrict background data usage. What we are looking at in this window is a connection profile. If I click over to the identity tab, we can see that a little more information. I can create profiles for different networks or just different configuration of the same network. This happens to be called wired connection one, but it could just as easily be named work or home or anything else that designates what this group of network setting is called. Here again, I can see the MAC address and the interface designation, and I can change the address of my system if it is required. Over in IPv4, I can choose how the system gets its address. It's set to automatic right now, because that's how this virtual network is configured. But you may need to set an address manually, and for that you need some specific pieces of information. We can do the same for the IPv6 setting. And security lets you connect to the securable Ethernet network, which can be found in corporate settings sometimes, but is rarely used in a home setting. If I made any changes here, I did need to click apply in order for them to take effect. Back here on the main screen, let's take a look at what this shows when I am disconnected. I will go here and unplug the network cable from my virtual machine, and now the status of my connection changes to cable unplugged. I will plug it back in, and now I am connected again. If you are plugged in and you are still not getting the connected message, double check that your network is configured to provide information automatically, or enter the address information manually and try again. Up here above the white box, I can use the plus button to add another connection profile, and down below it I can add setting for a VPN or virtual private network or a network proxy. Typically, you will know if you need to change any of these settings. VPNs and proxies both change how the network traffic is routed, and that's beyond the scope of this course. If you are using Linux on a laptop, on your system has a wireless adapter connected to it, you can connect to your network with Wi-Fi. I have Wi-Fi adapter connected to my machine here, and when I go into setting and Wi-Fi, I can see the network around me. I am able to connect with one and type in its password, and when I am connected, I can click the gear icon to see some more details. Most of these are the same for an Ethernet connection. While support for Wi-Fi adapter in Linux has gotten better recently, there are some adapters out there that need additional software to work or are just not compatible with the Linux. Be sure to search the model of your adapter and the term Linux to see how compatible it is. Or if you are looking to buy one, make sure it lists Linux compatibility before you purchase it. The current version of Ubuntu Desktop comes with the Firefox web browser pre-installed. It starts out right here in the dock. I can click here in the address bar and start typing to visit my favorite websites. I will visit ubuntu.com, or I can use the search bar to search for my favorite things. I will type here some interesting result. If I navigate to another page by clicking a link, I can use the back button to move back to the previous page, and I can use the forward button to move forward in my browsing history. If I really like this site, I can bookmark it. By choosing bookmarks and bookmark this page, you can edit the name of bookmark if you need to. This one's pretty long, so I will change it just to, as you can see on the screen, and then I will click done. Now if I browse away from this site and I want to get back to it quickly, I can go here to my bookmark, and there's my bookmark. The little house icon here takes you back to your home page, which by default is a kind of dashboard of top sites you have visited and some recommendations of article to read. I like my browser to start out with just a blank page, so I will go to the icon here, three stacked line, the hamburger button, and then I will go into preferences and I will change my home page to about colon blank here. You can change some other options around how Firefox works, including where to save downloaded files. By default, it's in the download folder and it's maybe a good idea to keep it there. There's quite a few other preferences that you can set here, but the specifics of Firefox are beyond the scope of this course. I will close out of here and hit my home button again, and there's my blank page. You will need to work with files and folder while you are using Ubuntu. Let's take a look at the basics. Here on my desktop, I will create the brand new folder. I will right click and then choose new folder. I will give it a name and then I will click the green create button. As you can see on the screen, I will make another folder as well. Right click, new folder, my other folder and create. I can double click on the folder and open it up. Or if I want to open both of these folders at the same time, I can paint them with my mouse and then press enter. Let's open up one window for each folder. The windows that are open are for the app called Files, which is over here on my sidebar. I got two little indicator lights over there showing that I have two windows for that app open. Clicking on that icon, I can see a preview of all the windows that app has open, and I can switch between them easily here. If I am already working inside the Files application, I can also paint some icons, press enter, and the selected folder will open up in tabs. As you can see on the screen, I will click the X to close these out. I will open up my other folder again. If I drag my folder into my other folder, it will move that folder, removing it from the desktop because both of the parent folders are on the same disk volume. If I dragged a file or folder from a different disk volume, like another partition or another internal hard drive or a USB drive, it would make a copy of that file, not move the file. As you can see on the screen, if I drag this folder back to my desktop and then hold down the control button, I get this little plus icon on the cursor, which means copy. When I drop the folder, the system makes a copy of it instead of moving it. I will delete that by right clicking and choosing move to trash. On a PC, I can use the delete key to get rid of a file, or on a Mac, I can press function delete. I will drag this folder again, this time holding down control and shift. The icon on the pointer changes to a little chain, which means I will create a link to what I am dragging. And that's indicated by this arrow overlay on the icon. A link means that this item is not really where it says it is. It's pointer to the real folder back over in this folder. As you can see on the screen, links can be handy for creating shortcuts to the folder or files which you access often. I can copy this link around my file system as a point to the other folder, but if I give the link to someone else, the pointer will try to find the file on their system, where chances are it does not exist. I will delete this link as well. And when I delete this link, it does not delete the original item. If I drag a folder and hold Alt or Option on Mac, I get a question mark on the pointer, and then when I release the mouse button, I get a little menu asking which kind of operation I want to do. These options are also available in the right click menu along with rename and several other choices. Here in this menu, I can choose properties to see some details about files and folders, including their full path and how much space they take up. On the side of the window, there's a series of shortcuts. The top item here shows the file that I have used recently. The next one for my home folder shows everything that is my user home folder, my space where I should store my own personal files. Most of the folders here are also over on the sidebar to give quick access to documents or photos or the others, and down toward the bottom I have a shortcut to the trash, which is where file I delete or store temporarily. Before they are erased for good, I will click into the downloads folder, which is where I have the exercise files for this course. They are zip archive, so let's extract the files from that archive and put them where they belong. When working with an archive file, we have a couple of options. Double clicking on the file, open it up in Archive Manager, where I can drag item out of an archive or add them to it. Or I can right click the file and choose extract here to pull everything out of the archive and create a folder with its contents. As you can see on the screen, I will do that. If I want to change how the file browser displays icon, I can do that up here in the top right. There's a list view, which is handy because it shows you how many items are in each folder and how large files are. And there's icon view, which is a little bit simplified, and I can further customize how this app displays file by going up to app bar and choosing preferences. I like to allow folder to be opened up in a list view, so I will turn that on and close the window, and then I will switch back to list view. Here's the folder we extracted earlier. This folder contains some different types of documents and files, so let's put them into their appropriate places. I will open up each of these folders and move their content. To select more than one item, I will click on the first one, hold down the shift key and click on the last one. And then I will move these photos into the picture folder. I will move the music file over to the music folder. These documents over into documents. The video into the videos folder and so on. I will move the website folder into documents as well. Now those are where they need to be. Notice that they got moved instead of being copied. If you did like, you can delete the zip file and this folder, or you can keep them around to use again later. Thumb drives, external hard drive and optical storage like CDs and DVDs are all pretty common ways of moving files around. Let's take a look at using a USB drive. I have plugged a USB thumb drive into my system. It shows up here on my desktop, so I will click to open it up in the Files app. I will open a new Files window and browse to my home folder. With these two windows open, I will copy some of the file from my home folder to my drive. I can right click here on the device in the sidebar and click the properties to find out a little bit more information, like how much space is used on the drive and what the total capacity is. When I am done using the drive, I will close its window and I can choose to eject it from the sidebar here, as you can see on the screen, or I can right click on it on the desktop and choose eject. If I just remove it without ejecting it, there might be still some activity going on, and if that gets interrupted, damage can occur to the files on the drive. And now I am ready to take those files to another computer. Ubuntu comes with a nice selection of software to get you started, but chances are you will want to install new program at some point. Let's take a look at how to do that. I will click on activities and type the word software, and here's an app called Ubuntu Software. This is an application that lets you browse for software to install. Across the top bar here are a couple of buttons to let you sort your view. You can either see all software, choose to see software that been installed on your system, or to see whether there are updates available for software you have installed previously. I will go back to all. The software is organized into categories, or you can search if you know what you are looking for. Let's look for a game. I will click on games and choose to show board games, and I can choose to sort by rating or by name. I will scroll down and look for an interesting game. This chess application looks interesting. I will click on it to find out some more information. Here's description and a screenshot, and if I scroll down, I can see some reviews and comments. Up here toward the top, I will choose install. I am prompted for my password. Because we are adding software to the system, I will type it in and press authenticate. When the download finishes, I will see a button that says launch in the software application. I can click it to open the game, or I can search for the app. There it is. I know, and now I can spend some quality time playing chess. Well, you get the idea. If you want to remove an application that you have installed, you can go back to the main screen and choose installed. You can scroll down to your software and click remove button. I need to enter my password to authorize the changes being made to the system. While there's a lot of software available from the software application, there are other ways to install software. Primarily, you can download an installer image or a pre-compiled binary, or you can download source code and build the software yourself. Let's take a look downloading an installation package. I will download the popular Autumn text editor from autumn.io. To do that, I will open the web browser and browse to autumn.io. I will scroll down a little bit. Here I have option to download a .deb file and .rpm file. On Ubuntu, the .deb file is what we want. The extension represents Debian, the distro on which Ubuntu is based. As we know earlier, the rpm one is for the Red Hat or distro derived from it. I will download the .deb file, and when it's done, I will go over to my downloads and open it up. That opens in the software app we saw earlier, and here we have the option to install it. Once it's done, it shows up over here in the installed, but down at the bottom in the adds on section. I will search to open up the new software, and there it is. We can also download a pre-compiled application file or binary, or build one from source code. But that's a little far from our user-friendly path, so I will leave those for you to explore on your own way. Any operating system going to have updates ranging from critical security patches to minor user ability enhancement. Ubuntu makes it easy to get and install these updates through Software Updater application. I will click the activities button and start typing software. There are two apps that show up that look like what we want. This one called Software and Updates. This gives us some option for what sort of software packages we can have the system search and keep track of. Generally, You will want to leave these check boxes alone unless you have a good reason to change them. You can change what location you are downloading from, because the system takes that it thinks is optimal. When you install over here on the updates tab, you can choose what updates to check for and when. And you can choose whether to install security updates automatically. That's generally a good idea. Over here under additional drivers, you can try to install different drivers for hardware your system. Be careful with that. Choosing a driver and does not work quite right can have consequences for your system, and maybe it not start up correctly. Again, this is the best left alone unless you have specific entry and exit plan and an idea of what it is that you are doing. I will close this now and open up software updater. The first thing the software updater does is to check all of the sources that it knows about to see if they have any new updates. These sources are called repositories, or repo for short. I will move this window up and open up the detail. As you can see on the screen, here I can see the available update for the software I have installed. At this point for me, there is not a whole lot since 1804 was just released a few weeks ago, and I don't have my third-party software installed on my Ubuntu. If you are curious about what a specific update does, you can click on it and open up the technical description section. You can see what changes are made and what the description of the changes are here. There is a setting button which launches the software and updates app we saw earlier. I have got some update to install, so I will click install now. As you can see on the screen, if you want to see the detail of what's going on behind the scene, open up the detail window. This will show the progress of the downloads and then all of the detail of the actual installation process. Watching this can introduce you to sort of things you will see if you start working in command line, or if you don't want that kind of detail, just close the details window. Depending on how many updates there are to install, the process can take a few minutes to complete. When the update complete, the system will notify you. Sometimes you will need to restart your system to apply updates. Ubuntu Desktop comes with suite of program called LibreOffice, which is free open source software suite meant to provide functionality similar to Microsoft Office. LibreOffice is made up of few different apps. There are Writer for word processing, Impress for slide presentation, and Calc, which is the spreadsheet application. Let's take a look at Writer first. I will open by searching for it. If you are familiar with Microsoft Word or Apple Pages, you will see how this is similar to both of them. There are ribbons across the top of the interface with commonly used features, and there's a sidebar here on the right when you can open up the document properties, page setup, and some other panels. Take some time to click around. I will open a document from my exercise file by clicking File, Open. Then I will navigate to my Documents folder and I will open the Marketing Plan document. I will select the file and choose Open. I will interact with the document a little bit and make some changes. As you can see on the screen, let's update the data here and change the color of this text. It's for marketing after all, so it should be eyes catching, right? And let's resize the image a little bit. There's a whole lot of features in Writer, and I encourage you to spend some time with these sample documents to learn about them. And you can create a new document from File, New, and choose Text Document. If you create a new document and want to save it, you can do that with the file menu or with the, as you can see, floppy disk icon up here in the ribbon. One thing you will want to be aware of when you save a document in LibreOffice is that these tools have their own open source document format. Some other software can read these, but if you are interacting with people using Microsoft Office, it can be a good idea to save in the Office format instead of the native LibreOffice format. Doing that can help the people you are collaborating with from getting confused. Generally, you will want to use the Microsoft 2013 XML format. You can find that in the drop down here in the bottom right, and you can scroll and choose Doc X. Then I will give my document a name and click save. When I change the format, I will prompt it just to make sure I really want to do this. Yes, I do. And I will tell writer not to bother me about the choices again. And now I have got a document saved in a compatible format. I will close writer for now. Let's take a quick look at Impress, which is the component of LibreOffice that we will use for making slide presentation. I will search for Impress and I will open up the application. When the software opens, I am creating with the window offering me a lot of templates to use for new presentation. If you are starting from scratch, go ahead and use one, but I will click cancel for now, and then I will open a PowerPoint file from the exercise files. With file open, browse to documents menu and I will choose marketing review.pptx and then I will click open. As you can see on the screen, if you have used to Microsoft PowerPoint or Apple Keynote, you will find this to be pretty similar. On a small screen like mine, this looks a little silly. I can make room temporarily by closing the property window here on the right. I can get it back by clicking the little icon. Over here on the left, I can see the slide view and I can switch between slides in the deck. I will switch to the second slide here and make a change. That sounds about right. Now I happen to know that this slide does not have any interesting animations on it. So let's change that. I will click over here on the right on this yellow flying star icon for animations. And then I will select the element that I want to animate. I will click the green plus to add animation and then I will preview what it looks like. There we go. So dynamic, the purple icon above the yellow star icon is for slide transition. These are the animation that happen between slides rather than the animation that happens for items on a slide like we have just done here. Take some time and experiment with the deck and explore some of other options available. When you are ready for your big presentation, you can press F5 to start slideshow or go up to slideshow in the menu bar and click start from the first slide. Use the arrow keys to move forward and backward and escape when you are done. As with Writer, you can save the file you have created, and by default it will try to save in the LibreOffice Impress format, which is fine if you are working with other LibreOffice users, but you might consider using the PowerPoint format. If you are working with people who are using that software, I will close out of Impress now. Let's take a look at Calc, the spreadsheet tools that part of the LibreOffice suite. Again, I will open it up from the search interface. I will type CALC and here it is. As you can see on the screen, when I open it up, I get a new blank spreadsheet. I will browse for and open spreadsheet from the exercise file. Here's a sales report for a month sale in a retail store. I will choose it and press open. If you are accustomed to Microsoft Excel or Apple number, This work is a similar way. You can type in cell to add text and add formulas. Down at the bottom, we have got a formula which we can see when we click in the cell and look here in the formula bar. This sums up all sale prices for this month. I will edit that to get the average price instead. I will change sum to average. Interesting, I will use Ctrl plus Z to undo that and put back to some spreadsheets or a whole world to themselves. So I can't show you every feature of this software, but take some time and create your own spreadsheets or modify the ones I have provided in the exercise file, which is attached to this lecture. And remember, if you are interacting with people on different platforms, be sure to save your documents in the compatible format. This is very important note. In this case, the XLSX that Excel expects. Before we move on from documents, I want to show you how to work with plain text as well. If you're working with code or other document that need to be in plain text rather than styled text, you can use the text editor tool. I will search for that and open it up. This interface is a little different than the LibreOffice program. I will click and open to open a document and then choose other documents. I will browse to my documents folder and open up the website folder, and then I will choose to open index.html. Ubuntu comes with the music player which can play audio files, podcasts, CD and radio streams. I will open up by clicking it here in the dock. As you can see on the screen, earlier I copied some mp3 file to my music folder and they show up right here under music. If they don't show up for you, you might need to click on import and then choose the folder where the files are. Then you will click import listed track. Down along the bottom of the screen, I have rewind and play, which turns into pause when I start playing a track. Fast forward and over on the other side, loop playback and shuffle playback. As you can see on the screen, here in the middle, there's a slider that represents the progress through the track. If I double click on the song, it starts playing. I can drag song into my play queue in the order that I want the player to play them. If I click this button and three dot, then I can choose Ctrl to edit the list, to shuffle or to clear the playlist. If you are using a native installation of Ubuntu on machine with the CD DVD drive, you will be able to play audio disc as well. There's the podcast section here. I can use it, look for podcast and subscribe to it. I will choose and add. I will start searching for wait, don't tell me, the NPR news quiz. Here it is, and I can choose subscribe to add it to my list. I will click close and there's my podcast. Under online sources, there's a radio section where you can install or listen to some online streaming stations. There's a few different ones built in and you can add your own pretty easy. It's always important to have a backup of your important data just in case something happened to your computer. I will click activity button and search for backups. I have my external flash drive plugged into my system. And for this lecture, I will use that as my backup file drive. If you have network file server, you can use that as well. To start up a backup, first I will choose folder to save here. My home folder selected. Under folders to ignore, the backup software won't backup my trash and it won't backup the content of my user folders, download folders. That may be a good idea. Then I will choose storage location. It's suggesting a cloud service, but I will change to my USB drive. The backup need to live inside a folder, whether it's on a disk or a file share. I will give a name for folder. It's chosen the name of my machine, but I will change it to Hayat backup, if it does not exist, the backup software will create it for me, and then under scheduling I can choose whether or not I want to use automatic backup. That certainly sound like a good idea, so I will turn it on. I can choose to run the backup every day or every week. I will switch to every day and we will keep files that are backed up forever. I will go back to the overview here. I can see that there have been no recent backups and that the next backup is today. That will happen sometime later, but I will click backup now to make the backup happen right now. The application needs some more software, so I will click install and I will authorize it. Now it's asking for a password. You can choose not to have a password, but it's a good idea to set a password on your backup. That way, if someone else plugs in your backup disk, they won't be able to easily access all your files. So I'll provide a password and then I will click forward. You will need to supply this password when you backup in the future. Unless you click remember password, and you will need to provide it when you restore your files. The backup's complete. To restore files, you can go through the backup interface and choose restore. This will let you restore file to the original location or to a different location, but it's restore everything. If you want to restore individual file, there is another way. I will open my file browser and I will go to my picture folder. If you right click on a file, there's an option to revert to a previous version. This will let you choose an earlier version of the file to restore. This is handy if you served over the wrong file or you made a change you did not like or something like that. You will be able where you want to restore from, when you want to restore from, and then you can click restore to get the file back. I haven't changed this file at all, but you can get idea. If you delete a file and want to get it back, and the backup software has you covered as well. I will delete some of my picture and I will even empty my trash. Those files are now gone from my computer. I needed them when it was last seen. I will select both of these files and then I will click forward. I will click restore to restore the files. I will type in the password for my backup and choose forward. And I can see that the software restores my missing files. Of course, backup will only happen if your backup disk is plugged in and your system is on. But outside of that, this software gives you a safety for your files. Let's take a look at adding another user to the system. Adding another user sets up a separate space with a separate home folder and their own desktop experience. If you have more than one human using a computer, it's a good idea to add a user for each of them, both to keep their documents separate and to allow each user to set up their working space the way they like. To set up a user in Ubuntu, I will go into Setting and then Detail and I will click Users. I will click on Unlock to enable me to make changes here. I can change my password if I want to, but I like my password, so I will cancel out of here for now. Now up in the top right of the window, there's an Add User button and I will click it. I will add account for my friend Ali. His full name is Ali Muhammad, and while I want to give him his own space, I don't want him to be able to make changes to my system. So I'll keep the current account type at standard instead of administrator. If he want to install software or change system setting, I will need to authorize it with my username and password as the system administrator. The system generates a username which gets used to create the actual account and becomes the name of the user's home folder. The system recommends some variations that I can choose, but I will just set it to the user's first name, Ali. I can set up a password or have the system prompt for a password when he tries to log in. I will leave it set that way that so I don't know this password, and then I will click add. Now that account shows up here at the top of the screen. I can click the choose users. I can set a photo for the user. I will set it to a photo. I will close out of here, and then I will log out using status bar at the top right of the screen. Then I will click my username and choose logout. I will choose the other user account, and I am prompted to set up a password now. If you are adding an account for someone else, you will want to let them choose and type a password, but for demonstration purpose I will set a password and then I will verify it, and then I will click sign in. The new user gets the new user treatment. They are shown the what's new screen, and we can click through that to clear it. This desktop and home folder are a separate space where the user can create and store their documents and customize the appearance to that link. This can use the same setting app to change their password in the future if they need to have. For now, I will log out of this user and back into mine. So in this lecture, you learn how to add new user. Be with me. See you in next lecture. I mentioned earlier that Linux is a multi-user operating system, and we have just seen how to create a new user. Any user on this system will be able to read the file and folder inside of the home folder of any other user. That's by design. And in order to help you understand how the sharing works between users, I need to take a slightly talking about file permissions. On a Linux system, users are organized into groups for management purpose and to make sharing file easier. So at any given time, a file has a user and group associated with it. In order to control access, we can tell the system how to treat access to a file based on the owner of the file, the group of the file, and a third category called others, which is everyone who is not the user that created a file and who is not a member of the file's group. We can give these different categories the ability to read, write, and execute a file. I will open up my file browser and right click on my documents folder, and then I will choose property. I will click on the permission tab, and here are some options to set the access level for the owner, me, the group, and other. Normally, I have access to create and delete files that are inside of my home folder. The items in this list go in order of increasing privileges. So while I can create and delete files, I can also access them, which means I can read their content, and I can list them, which means I can see them when it comes to the group setting. Ubuntu work a little differently than other Linux distribution. Most other distro block access to the group and other entirely, but Ubuntu leaves the somewhat open in order to make sharing file a little easier. Here in the next section, we see group that the same name as my user. When my user was created, there was also a group of the same name created, and that group can access my files. And other here also can access my files. So any user that I create, as long as I don't change their group membership, will be in others. And this is a setting that control access for those people. To prevent access to the my home folder by other users, I could set this to none. List file only would allow them to see the files but not read the contents and access the files. As I mentioned earlier, let's user read a file but not modify it. I will leave the permission here for now. There is a little more to do to it, like the fact that if you want to share a folder deeper down in hierarchy, you need to allow access to higher level sub higher level folders for the most part, but that's topic for a more advanced course. If you like to learn more about how permission work, so I will recommend to see my course Linux Command Line on Udemy. If you're using your Linux computer on a network at home, at school, or at work, you can connect to a file server to share file with other people on that network. I will open up the file application and click on other locations. Down here at the bottom, there is a space to connect to a server. There's a few components to being able to connect to a server depending on the service that it's running or the operating system that the server's running. You will need to specify a certain protocol. If you click the question mark here, you can see how those line up. I'm going to connect to a Windows server and that using Samba or SMB. So I will type in SMB:// The next piece of information you need in is an IP address. It could be a numeric IP address or it could be host name. My system has the IP address. So as you can see on the screen, so I will put that in and then I will choose connect. Here I can see the files shared that are available. I will click on user. In order to access this share, I need to click registered user and provide my username and password. You can choose whether you want the system to forget your password immediately, remember it for a little while, or remember it forever. I will choose to remember it forever and then I will click connect. Here my user folder on my Windows computer, I can browse around, I can move file back and forth. As long as you stay on the same network and as long as the server's address does not change, you will be able to send files back and forth. There are few ways for you to find out what's going on behind the scene in Ubuntu. First, let's take a look at what the system is currently doing. I can open the system monitor from search and here I can see a list of all of the programs that are currently running and how much of different resources they are taking up. Some of these are apps you will recognize and other are some background processes. Which system runs, you can sort the display by CPU and memory to see what's taking up a lot of resources. For example, I will open a game, I will sort the list by process name and here I can see the game in the list. From here I can end the process, terminating an application if I need to, but it is not recommended to terminate application. This is a last resort if any application freeze. The resources tab shows you a series of charts that indicate what resources are being used. This can be interesting to get a bird eye view of how your system is doing what. And the file systems tab shows you devices, mount points, type and the total available and used space on each of your disk. There's a lot of things here and most of them you don't need to worry about. Home here is on the primary partition and so are some of these other file systems. So they all show the same information and these that say snap here are all small self-contained file systems that some program are using. So that's what the system is currently doing. I can also look at what the system did in the past. The logs application shows this. I will search for it and open it up. The computer keeps record of things that it does and those are recorded here in the log. It does not record everything that you as a user do, but it records most of what it does at the system level. The information can be very useful for troubleshooting issues. It can be interesting to browse through here to get an idea of what the system does behind the scene, but you should not read too much into it. There's a lot of information here, and it's easy to go down and rabbit hole of figuring out what everything is. As we cannot see the terminal earlier in our lectures, the command line interface that a lot of people associate with working on Linux and with modern Linux desktop, it's entirely possible to avoid using the command line interface for a lot of tasks. But as you learn Ubuntu, it's good to be at least familiar with the command line environment, if only so you don't think of it as a scary. The terminal or command line interface is a text interface where we can use program and command to manage the system, work with data, and do all kind of other things. The terminal that we see is really a shell, in this case one called bash shell, which is pretty common. I can open up the terminal application from search, or I can press Ctrl plus Alt plus T here in Gnome. To open it up, I will zoom in bit to make this little easier to see. You interact with the command line by typing specific commands. For example, I can type is to list ls command to list the file in the current folder, and then I will press enter. And I can type cd to change the directory into one of the folders. As you can see on the screen, let's go into the document. The pw command prints the working directory, or it tells you what folder in the file system you are currently inside of. There are hundreds of commands that you can run at the command line, and if you start looking at a user forum or help article or start exploring add new packages and software to your system, you are bound to run across some of them. One of the most common you will see is sudo, which we use to temporarily borrow access to the super user account. When you are using a Linux machine, you are always acting as a user. As we all know, in this case I am using my user, but some action need more authority on the system than even administrative users like me. The user implied in sudo is called root, and it has unrestricted access to the system. So for some operations like changing the system setting or installing software, we have to temporarily use root power to do that. And when you use sudo, the changes you can make can be irreversible. I will use the command apt update, which is part of command line process for checking for the system updates. I will press enter, and the system want my password because I am using sudo. I will type it in, but you will see no characters appear. That's normal. You might remember that when we check for updates in the desktop environment before, I had to enter my password too. But when this update process finished, then I can type sudo space apt space upgrade to check out whether the new software that is available in the repositories can be applied to my system. But you see, in this lecture will maybe different from what's showing up on your screen. Here I can type y to update, but I am going to type n to cancel right now, and I will type clear to clear the screen. Like I said, there is a lot of commands and lot of learn about those commands. If you come across one that you want to learn about, type man followed by the command name like ls man, bring up that manual page or the built-in documentation for this command. Use the arrow keys to move up and down, or spacebar to move forward by pages. And you can press Q to quit. The terminal can look as you can see on the screen, but it's really an integral part of being an efficient and well-rounded Linux user. If you are interested in learning more about command line environment, I would recommend to see my course on Udemy, Linux Command Line Basics. To browse files in places other than my home folder, I can open up the app and choose other locations. This shows me the disk attached to my system. Here's my hard drive, and if I connected other disk or USB drives or optical drives, they shows up here as well. If I click on my hard drive, I see lot of folder with names. This is the root of the file system, and these items are what make the system work. When you are learning about using Ubuntu, you maybe won't need to deal with these, but I will give you a quick overview. You can think of the root of the file system like trunk of a tree and any other folders. Network share or storage device on the system is a branch of that or branch of another branch. My home folder is inside the folder called home, in a subfolder called my username which I logged in. That path would be represented as a slash home slash my username. You will see file path written out like that in forum and support article online. I won't talk too much about a lot of the folder here at the root of the drive because they are not specific to using Ubuntu desktop, but rather they are a part of every Linux distribution. If you become a system administrator or more advanced Linux user, you will start exploring these more. Like bin and sbin are where many of the system application or binaries live. Etc is where a lot of configuration information for system apps and services is stored. Media is where disks that get mounted on the system, like CD, images and external drive shows up. Temp is a folder that system and application use for temporary storage. Things in here get removed after they are not deleted, and some of the other folder have library file and other shared file in there. Again if you are new to desktop environment, you maybe won't need to go exploring through the file system too much, so don't worry too much about what these folder are right now.
Thank you.